So I have to tell you, I don't like working out. I know some of you do. In fact, some of you chew barbells for breakfast. That's not me. And for years, I had avoided going to the gym. I had all sorts of excuses. It's too expensive. It's too far. And in 2012, they built a gym about half a mile from my house. And it was $9.99 a month. So I was out of excuses. So of course, not liking to break a sweat, my attendance at the gym was inconsistent. Sometimes I'd go once a week, sometimes twice a month. I couldn't keep a habit of going to the gym. About a year after I joined, I ran into one of the gym managers at my local Kroger store. And he came up to me, you know, asked me, "How are you, sir? How are you finding the gym? We haven't seen you in a long time." And I started telling him, "Well, you know, I am busy, I travel, I don't really enjoy spending time at the gym." The way he looked at me, I knew that he had heard all my excuses before. And he said to me, "Sir, the reason why most people don't get the full benefits of their gym membership is because of how they see." Like, what do you mean? Yeah. How they see the gym will determine what they do with the gym, which will determine what they get out of the gym. Do you want to lose 50 pounds? Do you want some muscle definition? When you have a clear picture of what you want to achieve, then you can use the gym well. If not, when you feel the burn, when it starts to hurt, you can't see past the pain. You have to see past the pain. Now, this guy was freaking me out right now. But he had a point. Think about it. That's a metaphor for life, for anything we do in life. If we don't see correctly, we don't do correctly. And it's sort of like our Toastmasters program. It offers immense benefits, but not everyone is taking advantage of the benefits it has to offer. That is why today, in fact, every year, less than 0.5% of our membership worldwide earns their DTM. Now, let me be clear. I don't care about the DTM title. Yes, I said it. I can say it. I'm a DTM, okay? I don't care about the title. Some of you will walk tomorrow, will applaud, but the title does absolutely nothing for you. It's the DTM journey. It's the process. It's in the process that we grow, that we develop, that we get the full benefits of the journey. But most people don't, because they don't have a good picture of the program. So tonight, as a has-been, as a past district governor, DTM, I've drunk the Kool-Aid as someone who has taken the journey and reaped the benefits, I'd like to share with you three areas that will help you maximize your Toastmasters membership. Three areas are the club leadership experience, the district leadership experience, and the program volunteer experience. And somebody's like, "Oh, I thought you had something more exciting." No. I'm not being paid for this, so. Club leadership experience, district leadership experience, and the program volunteer experience. So let's talk about the first point, club leadership. In 2004, I joined my home club, Atlanta Master Crafters. And it was a small club. They had started, I think, the year before. 6 months into my membership, they asked if I could serve as secretary treasurer. You all know we double on those roles sometimes. And I jumped in and did. Fast forward to June of 2005, early June, my father died. Now, Toastmasters did not kill my father, okay? He didn't die because of Toastmasters. My father died early June of 2005, so I took a few weeks off to spend with my family and grieve with my family, go through the process. While I was gone, my club members took advantage of that and elected me president. Now, you guys in this country have a strange way of consoling a grieving person. But I took it in stride and I jumped into the opportunity to serve. We started that term with 8 people, 4 of whom were officers filling 7 officer positions. You do the math. But we were determined to transform our club. So we started throwing ideas on the table. The first thing we did was we went to what we call our parent club, Horizon. Any Horizon members here? One person. Please give her a round of applause. What?
Former.
Okay, you still count.
Former.
Okay, you still count. Cindy's a former. All right, you all count. Fine, we're not taking roll call here. But we went to Horizon, which was a very big club and a very successful club, and we said, listen, partner with us, because our meetings are thin. I mean, you guys know how it is. You've had those meetings where you have 2 people in attendance, and you have a speaker, an evaluator, our counter, a general evaluator. But, you know, the show must go on. So we went to Horizon and we asked them to partner with us, become a buddy club. Every week they'd send 1, sometimes 3 people, and our meetings looked full. We did things like inviting the district governor then, Felicia Artis, to speak, and we publicized this to the community. A governor was showing up somewhere. They didn't know what governor she was.
It worked.
We invited Dwayne Smith, world champion of public speaking. We publicized it. He could have been the world champion of gargling water. They didn't care. They showed up. We ended that year as a President's Distinguished Club. 28 members. But what it taught me was the power of creative leadership. Thinking outside the box. A number of you remember when I ran for LGM and my mantra was QM equals QC, quality meetings equals quality clubs. Where do you think it came from? When I served as a club leader. The skills you learn in the challenges you face as a club leader are transferable to other positions, even work. Tell you a quick story about Jim Geiger. Jim Geiger was the founder and CEO of See Beyond. Do we have any See Beyonders here? I see Marilyn. Yeah. You can tell I have a lot of history in the district, right? Yeah. Jim was the founder, and by the way, See Beyond is now called Birch. They've been bought out. But he was a Toastmasters fan. He supported their club. At every conference we had a table, they sponsored events, sent their members to things we did. They had this thing at work called the Senior Leadership Team Challenge, where they pit Toastmasters against senior executives. Table topics, contests, or speech contests. And this was big. Often the tabletop, the Toastmasters won. But as a CEO, Jim would attend a lot of these events. I met him at an event and I asked him, so tell me, what is it about Toastmasters that causes you to support your club so much? I thought he had been a Toastmaster in the past. I was like, yeah, well, the members the employees wanted it, so we believe in supporting our employees and we let them start it. But things changed when a lady who worked for me, who was shy, insecure, lacked confidence, joined Toastmasters. And he started seeing the changes in her over the months. And at some point, she became an officer, and her growth hockey sticked. She could now stand in front of her peers, 60, 70 executives, and control the room. At that point, he knew that if this program can do this for this person, we need to get behind it. You see, her role as a club leader changed how she worked. It changed how she conducted herself at work. I know a number of you have had similar experiences. You get promotions because of the things you've learned at being a club leader. If you have the opportunity to serve as a club leader, it will teach you creative leadership. Take it. Look past the pain. See past the pain. It is so worth it. Second thing I want to talk about is the district leadership experience. In 2006, I asked, Lee Holiday had just been elected as district governor. And Lee had been my mentor, fellow club member, and friend. So, as good friends do, I asked him, "Hey, Lee, what can I do for you? How can I help?" Yeah, you can, if you know Lee, you know what he said. "You can serve as an area governor." "Yeah, sure, I will." "What does an area governor do?" "You visit some clubs, you support them, answer questions. It's easy." Yeah. It was not easy. I worked hard. It is hard work. If anybody tells you that being an area director is easy, they've been drinking something. It is not. But it is fun. It was an amazing experience. The first thing I noticed was that my view of the Toastmasters program started to expand. Because prior to that, as one person, as someone in one club, my view of the Toastmasters program was limited to my club. But as I visited other clubs and I saw how they ran their meetings, the programs they conducted, the ideas they put forth at their meetings, it gave me a bigger picture. But the bigger thing being a district officer did for me was that it expanded my network. As I visited clubs for special events, not just their club meetings, I was interacting with the members, with the officers, often with the company managers, company executives, and it dawned on me that, hey, here I am building some solid relationships. You may have heard this, but your network is your net worth. Your network is your net worth. My district experience increased my contacts. As a professional speaker, and a number of you are in this room, as a professional speaker, where do you think I went to when I started looking for places to speak? Not the clubs, no, that's not the clubs. Corporate clubs. Because I had built relationships over time. Nationwide is a client. Home Depot is now a client. My executive coaching business works because a Home Depot employee who was a Toastmaster introduced me to the company that I work for. For some of you, it might be work. For some of you, it might be a spouse. Single folks. My district experience opened me up to my first corporate speaking engagement, and it was a disaster. It was a disaster. I'll tell you the quick story. In 2007, we started the club at GE Finance in Alpharetta. Are they still alive? Is that club still alive? Yeah, okay, good, fine. I'm glad it's not dead. But through the process of starting the club, chartering the club, I got to interact with a number of the site executives. They were having a conference in the fall where they bring together the legal firms and the accounting firms that work with them, and they asked if I could be their opening keynote speaker. What do you think I said? Yeah, of course. So the day came, I got to the Ritz-Carlton Buckhead, gave my keys to the valet, walked into the door. The organizer met me. Man, guys, this was my first gig. I was speaking for GE at the Ritz-Carlton. My confidence was this high. My chest was this wide with pride. Till he opened the door to the auditorium. There were about 250, 300 senior executives. These folks were the partners, the principals of the firms. I was a young buck. What was I going to tell them? Panic set in. When they started reading my introduction, at that moment it sounded like an obituary. And at the end of it, they said, please welcome Kene Luanyosi. So I got up on stage, people applauded. I gave my first line, it landed well, and then I forgot my speech. I looked at them, they looked at me. I looked at them, nothing. So I got off the stage, looked at my notes, got back on stage, turned around, and forgot my speech again. Yeah, Jesus, thank you. Yeah, thank you. You feel me, right? That was the perfect time for an earthquake, a fire drill, a heart attack or something, but nothing. So, I got off the stage again, picked up my notes, got back on stage. What do you think happened? No, I didn't forget my speech. I said it was a disaster, not the end of the world. I gave my speech, but by then I had lost the audience. In fact, the lady who invited me was sitting right in front and she was as mad as a viper. I avoided her. At the end of my speech, they gave me a polite applause. You all know the applause you give when you don't enjoy your speech. I grabbed my stuff, said thank you without looking at her, and I was out of there. My network gave me a devastating experience that taught me never, ever to forget my speech. Now, since then, I've been fortunate to speak to audiences of over 1,000, and it has never happened again. What will you do with your network? If you serve the people you are meant to serve as a district officer, it will expand your network, because Zig Ziglar said, you can get anything you want if you help as many people as possible get what they want. When you walk into a club, those members need your help. Yes, some of them are cantankerous. Sometimes you want to slap them. I know. I've been there. But if you see past the pain, it is so worth it. It is so worth it. The third and final thing I'll talk about is the program volunteer experience. We are a volunteer-led organization. But some people do more than others. And it's in the doing that you get. We all pay the same dues, right? Yeah. Okay, yeah, I know some clubs charge like $100 or something. We all pay the same dues. But some get more out of this program because they get involved. Who are the conference volunteers? Please stand. All conference volunteers, please stand. If you're volunteering at this conference, give them a round of applause. Of course, you know what you should do. Thank you very much. I have been a part of about 12 or 16 conferences, if you throw in TLIs. It is a lot of work. It is a lot of work, but in the work, you are developing skills that you never know when you might use them. Let's take, for example, the person who's running this conference. Not just the program quality director, but the co-chairs, Carrie. Where's Carrie? Carrie and, yeah. So after this conference, both of you are allowed to put on your resume, event planner. Past district governors can attest to that. It takes a lot of work, and a number of the volunteers have served at so many conferences. The people who decorate are training, developing skills in decoration. The hospitality folks upstairs are developing skills in being nice to people. Because you all know after you've had a few glasses that you get a little cantankerous, yeah? Yeah, the hospitality folks are saying, go, can I talk? Something that we don't talk too much about is the youth leadership program. A number of people have spent time working on the youth leadership program, and it has taught them how to relate with youth. Vicky Nathan has run youth leadership programs for God knows how long. I don't even know, 5 years. Okay, and we now have, as part of our fall conference, the speech contest for teenagers. But let me tell you a bigger story about the power of this program volunteer experience. Guyana is a small country in South America. Anybody from Guyana? Okay, you feel me? Okay, the Guyanese, so you guys can relate to this story. Population of about 800,000 people. Such a small country has the highest rate of suicide. The world average is 16 people to every 100,000. In Guyana, it is 44 people to every 100,000. Think about it for a second. A country of 800,000 people and their suicide rate is more than 2 times that of the global average. The government they've been working on programs to help people to prevent suicide, to sort of alleviate the problem, and they've had some success. But recently they noticed that the rate of suicide amongst teenagers started to grow quickly at an alarming rate. Now, you know that it is one thing to deal with adults and a different thing to connect with the youth. And they could not connect with them. The government organizations were having a hard time. Last year, I think it was August or September, Roy Ganga, is Roy here?
Yeah.
Okay, good, so I can talk about him. Roy, a past district governor who is originally from Guyana, met someone on Facebook who was talking about this teenage problem with suicide. And they were trying to figure out, okay, what can they do to help? Fast forward to March of 2016, Roy got to spend 3 weeks in Guyana. In 3 weeks, Roy spoke at 17 high schools to 3,500 students. He even got to be on TV twice. And they asked him to come speak on TV. He thought that there was going to be a host for an interview. He got there, they said, "Sir, there's the desk, there's the chair, there's the camera. It's yours." But he survived. At every school, students would come up to him after and say, "Thank you. Finally, somebody who understands us. Somebody who gets it. Somebody who is not judgmental or preaching at us. Somebody who knows where we are." The government had tried. Organizations had tried. How come this one guy was able to get through to them? Was it because he's a past district governor? No. Was it because he lived in the US? No. You have to go back to 2005. Roy started running youth leadership programs in libraries in Alpharetta at his church. And over the years, he just did it because it was something he loved doing. 2016, he's connecting with teenagers and helping them see a different path. As we talked, Roy shared something with me that I'd like to tell you about. This is a letter from one of the teenagers he spoke to. Her letter says, "Hello, sir. I'm the girl you spoke with yesterday at Swami School. I really appreciate speaking with you and being able to finally open up to someone about what I'm going through. Thank you for listening. This might not mean much to you guys, but this girl had tried to kill herself by drinking bleach and 20 sleeping tablets. And she did not succeed. Now, if you have had any experience with suicide, you know that if somebody attempts suicide and they fail and they don't get help, they can't connect with and they most likely will succeed. Thank you, sir. Finally, somebody who I can talk to. Thank you for listening. I can guarantee you that this girl will not attempt suicide again." But the story does not stop there. You see, it turns out that her younger sister was also thinking about killing herself. Yes, it's a big problem in Guyana. But because Roy had connected with this person and she had an outlet to express her frustration, her younger sister had an outlet with her older sister. Think about it. One family would have lost 2 children. Guyana would have lost God knows how many teenagers, a generation. But one guy who had been running youth leadership programs since 2005. I don't know what your program volunteer experience will do for you. I don't know what being a conference chair or conference volunteer will do for you. I don't know what being running a youth leadership program or speechcraft will do for you. I don't know. But what I do know is that when the opportunity comes, I hope you are ready. Because it's not a matter of if, but when. But opportunity will present itself to you. If you're ever asked to be a program volunteer, jump at it. See past the pain. Yes, it's a lot of work. See past the pain. In 2014, my wife and I started running 5K races. You don't believe me? Somebody said, "Really?" We started running 5K races, and in last year we ran the Pichu Road Race for the first time. My goal is to run a marathon in 2 years. Now I am more consistent at the gym because I see what the gym will do for me. How I see the gym has changed the way I use the gym. Now I can run intervals at the gym. Now I can work out my legs. Now I can see past the pain because I have a goal. What will you do? Is it going to be club leadership, district leadership, or being a program volunteer? Here's my encouragement. If you miss a meeting and they elect you a club officer, see past the pain. If you are asked to serve as a district leader, what will you do?
See past the pain.
And if you are asked to volunteer for a program, a conference, or youth leadership, what will you do?
See past the pain.
Thank you.
Good job.
Ooh. I got a gift.
I was listening. Kene, as you've sown your legacy this evening to District 44, we would be honored to present this appreciation of gratitude and deep appreciation as our keynote speaker this evening for our opening ceremony for District 44 Spring Conference 2016. Thank you.
Your boy. Sorry.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.